This is Off Planet Radio.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to Off Planet Radio, Off Planet TV. I'm Emily Moyer. Randy Moggins is on vacation right now, and so I will be not flying solo because I have co-pilot tonight. So I want to welcome back Dani Katz, Off Planet Radio. How you doing, Dani?
Good. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Before we, because I forgot to do it the way Randy likes, before we get started, just want to remind everybody that you can find everything at offplanetradio.com, and you can support us at patreon.com/offplanetmedia. And thank you for all of the patrons out there. Like, you guys are awesome, and you're making this magical for us. So just wanted to take care of that right away before we get into the interesting stuff. So Dani Katz, welcome back. How you doing? It's been a little while since you've been with us on regular Off Planet Radio.
Yeah, it's been a minute for sure. Yeah,
since the cliff bashing.
There was no bashing. It was grilling.
You got bashed. You got bashed by the cliff people is what I meant. Like, you didn't bash cliff.
There was some bashing headed.
Yeah. Way. Yeah. But you handled it like a champ. You handled it like a champ. And yeah, and like, you've been doing some cool stuff. You had a really good workshop recently. Yeah.
I did. I think it, I launched my book since the last time that I was on your guys' show. So there's been Bookland and quantum languaging workshops and an uptick in videos and content making and all that fun stuff.
Cool. And by the time this goes out, you guys will also have seen the first episode of Dani's new show that I've joined her on, Words with Dani. So we're excited about that. And we have an awesome show for you here tonight. And so I'm going to tell you guys a little about that. Our guest tonight is an investigative journalist. She is the founder and the editor-in-chief of Honey Colony. She's the director of the award-winning documentary, The Vanishing of the Bees, and she's a functional medicine coach. And most importantly, she's also friends with both Dani Katz and Sonia Barrett. And that makes her crazy enough for our liking, you know what I mean? Anyway, she's here to talk with us about censorship, the politics of CBD, the vanishing of the bees, and how there's one genocidal company that is tied to all that stuff. So, Maryam Henein, welcome to Off Planet Radio.
Thank you for having me. Thank you, Dani. I'm very happy to be here.
Yeah. So, before we just jump into the topics here, I would like you to tell us a little bit about your personal story and how you came to be doing what you're doing.
So I'm from Montreal, Canada, making me a Canadian, and came here now, I think, 20 years ago when I was 29 at kind of the height of my Saturn return. I stepped into a crosswalk and I was hit by an SUV and dragged 49 feet in front of the Bodhi tree, which is now defunct. Mm-hmm. So dragged from one crosswalk to the next, broke several bones, including my left femur, and had to be outfitted with a 14-inch metal rod, which I removed 4 years later. And that really kind of was my introduction to Western medicine in this country, coming from Canada, having had insurance, not even being told that I needed physio. I used yoga to rehabilitate myself, to learn how to walk again. And almost died and was looking for something that was bigger than me to give back and to be of service. And the bees flew into my life 4 years later, and I'm super grateful because they gave my life purpose. And we know today that purpose is one of the factors towards longevity, having a sense of meaning in your life. So I really had to become my own best health advocate to walk again. And after that traumatic hit, it took me a long time to realize I had PTSD, and my body just kind of exploded. And, you know, then I discovered, oh, I'm allergic to gluten, and I'm allergic to dairy, and I'm allergic to sugar, and I have to go on a candida cleanse, and now I have insomnia, and now I have a grapefruit-sized cyst. Everything that happened after that kind of used it as a deep dive. And then learning about our food supply and thinking at the time, okay, well, the bees are just going to be one project and I'll move to something else. And they stuck, pun intended.
Yeah.
And I've been studying the food supply ever since. Was then ironically exposed to chemicals on three occasions after making the movie, then diagnosed with lupus and fibromyalgia, and have always been kind of a biohacker, but didn't have that term, used right. guinea pig, and have since gotten knowledgeable about functional medicine, studied metabolomics, and have this website where I deal with sick people every day. And also, as an investigative journalist, what I do is connect the dots and perceive the patterns. And there's so many patterns and significant things that are occurring that are culpable behind all of this.
Yeah, well, it is your story. Like, there's more and more of, like, the more people I talk to, the more I realize that the people who are really doing like interesting work and working on themselves and coming to a place of understanding about the world that is different than the general public have all had a similar story where they've had sort of a health crisis and then sort of having to, in my case, I took it as like sort of when I changed my diet, years of sort of trauma and programming started to break down in a way that they hadn't before, that was kind of traumatic at the time, but allowed me the opportunity to work on them in a way that I could never before because I didn't really identify it in the same way. So it's fascinating that you have, you know, really a similar story yourself. So, and lots of people out there that listen to the show do as well. So
I agree. Talking to sick people, I can't attribute that definitely some trauma will awaken your consciousness. Unfortunately, there's so many people that are still asleep. However, I think I had a spiritual awakening at 13. All that to say, I see a lot of people that have had a chronic illness, something that makes them take their health into their own hands and certainly makes them wake up at least to the food supply, not necessarily the matrix of what is really going on. But yes, unfortunately, we need a tragedy to wake up as humans.
Yeah, it is.
It does seem like the food supply is a pretty common gateway into matrix busting. Like, I do hear that. And it does seem like a really accessible way. And it's also so experiential for people who are going through it. So, like, it makes sense.
I agree. I think that these processed foods are helping keep people awake. It's like that weird, you know, person who smokes two packs of cigarettes, no health problems, decides to quit, all of a sudden his body explodes, but he was sustaining himself, and a lot of people are subsisting on what now seems like a very strange way to eat, mm-hmm. and it's tied in to their consciousness, and the more sensitive you become, the more sensitive you become, and a lot of times that goes with food. Food is thy medicine. It's not just, you know, Hippocrates had meant something when he said that. And doctors only get 4 hours of nutritional education.
I heard one. 4 hours is more than I did. I heard that they only get one. Yeah, no, Dani, your point is well taken. Like, what I find is there's like a few pathways that people come in to wake up. It's usually either through, like, there's the conspiracy door, which is only part of the wake up. So some people come and then they find the nutrition piece and the health piece later. Others come through the health door and then they find their way there. You know, and then others like sort of like through just the weird like political thing and then figuring out that one side is the same as the other side and, you know, whatever, but they've noticed that both sides somehow vote Monsanto in, so that takes them to the food part
right.
of it.
Psychedelics are really good matrix yeah. busters. Festivals are functioning right. in that way. The yeah. food thing seems to be a little bit more like painful. The people, those of us who take that path, you know, I think that the three of us have that in common, the path through the body and through guinea pigging ourselves and yeah. being on the front lines of progressive healing.
Yeah, absolutely. So, okay, so what I want to kind of get into here in the first hour is the work that you've been doing recently about writing about CBD and the sort of a censorship that you've been experiencing as a result of it. First of all, can you tell people a little bit about what your connection is with CBD, and how you came in to be working with it, and what it is that you've been writing about that has been so controversial?
I missed a big swath of that. My mic went off. So can you hear me right now? Because I'm using the phone.
I can hear you.
But that might be that might not be satisfactory.
I can hear you.
I can hear you great.
Okay. All right. So I missed what you were saying, but in regards to CBD, having honey colony and having the tagline is where the hive decides what's healthy, and we're empowering people to become their own best health advocate in an era of disinformation. And so looking and being on the cutting edge, offering things like silver to combat the antibiotic resistance epidemic, offering molecular hydrogen to offer the smallest antioxidant to combat oxidative stress. So in looking at ways to heal my own autoimmune condition, 2 years ago, came across CBD and started selling another brand. And they were quite anal about what we could say and what we couldn't say. And at the time, I was very indignant as a journalist, like I believe in the First Amendment, we're offering sourcing, there's nothing wrong. And then ultimately falling, going separate ways and creating our own CBD that was specifically formulated when I found Eliza Moriarty, who's our master herbalist, that saying, this is what I'm dealing with. I want something to combat with maybe Lyme. 2 years ago, people didn't really know about biofilm. It's still not really understood or recognized in the mainstream, and it's very much part of Lyme and a lot of issues. And so,
Maryam, when you say they were pushing back against what you could say, do you mean one of the two CBD companies? Mm-hmm. Who is that?
The CBD company that I was selling on Honey Colony at the time did not like the articles that we were publishing because we were using, for instance, the word CBD. And I thought at the time very naively that the guy was making a big deal out of it coming from the stance of a journalist. Then creating our own brand that is not like nothing on the market has been described as the Lamborghini of CBD because everyone and their mama is making CBD now. Mm-hmm. And we really did our homework and we believe in quality. And then going through what I call the year of playing whack-a-mole in 2017 and experiencing all of these shutdowns. So PayPal, Square, Stripe, all these mainstream not wanting to take our money. Take our money, please. I have this amazing product and these clients and you don't want my money. And then discovering the politics of CBD and finding out that Maryam Henein has bud and bees in common with Bayer, like just so happens, and not being able to prove anything. And I think you told me, Dani, that I don't need to prove anything. I could just state the facts. And the fact is that the main company bringing to market on June 27th, Epidilox, is GW Pharma, is partnered with Bayer Crop Science. So happens, and them wanting to seemingly dominate the market, and they're in bed with the FDA and making it quite hard for dietary supplements to help people. So if you were going to go on this medication or the other ones, you're looking at spending, I think, $2,000 to $400. You could buy a bottle of amazing CBD for $100 or less and be good for the month. Or, you know, why do you need to spend all this money? How is the natural plant made by God, Mother Earth, universe, whatever you want to call the force, it's illegal, but the fake synthetic molecule is a Schedule II. How does that make fucking any sense?
Well, what? It makes dollars, so it doesn't actually matter if it makes sense.
It makes sense.
What reasons did PayPal and Square and those companies give you for shutting you down?
Selling CBD, even though my formula has less than 0.3 THC and comes from industrialized hemp, holding our money as well and debilitating us because we lost. I mean, if you have 2 weeks of not being able to do a transaction, there's $30,000 right there. Then how do you subsist? I'm not a big corporation. I'm a startup. This was made over 6 years. So from 2015 to 2016, my company went from $200,000 to $1 million in sales. Kudos. And then into 2017, we lost about 200,000. We had customers, sick customers. I say, you know, these people aren't waiting for a lipstick from MAC. These are sick people that waited from July to January because we were so behind, and CBD is expensive. If you're buying a CBD isolate from China or India, no, that's not expensive. You can make cheap CBD. But if you're doing it properly, that's the cost. I'm not cutting corners. So it's a testament of this medicine, and having people say, oh, I went to buy another wine while I was waiting, didn't do as well. And now I'm not even able to link on Honey Colony out of fear to, I had to create a whole new site, Simply Transformative. I'm not able to link it. So we have this great repository of articles on Honey Colony, and I have people asking, I can't find Superior, I can't find Superior, and being concerned of even putting a link.
On your own website to your own product. So can you, just because I think that there's a lot of people in our audience that are up on a lot of the issues around marijuana, but I think the issues around CBD are actually much more confusing. Like, yes. I think there's a lot of people, myself included, to a certain extent, was under the impression that CBD is legal because when I go to Erewhon, everything has CBD in it, right? So, like, to me, I'm like, oh, this is legal.
It is legal. It is legal.
Right, right. So can you explain to people what you're saying here when you're talking about the legalities of it and what, like, and what's going on? Like, why is it that they feel that they can come after you for doing something that is legal?
Well, let's state first that things are all technicalities, and right, also this country coming from Canada is one giant loophole. And doing things in manners when it's the same thing. So if we take the cannabis plant, we can extract it, and there's different strains, right? Ideally, you want to have a whole plant synergy. You want to have all these terpenes just the way God intended, or right, you know, input Mother Earth. However, because of the strangeness of the laws that started with reefer madness, all the misinformation, you can have CBD from industrialized hemp, which means less than 0.3 THC.
You can or you can't?
You can. You yes. can also have CBD with more THC. So it's technically the same plant. However, it's grown, as we know, we mess modern agriculture
right.
with plants. And this is it. So if I'm speaking to a sick person, and I ask, well, what, you know, I'm giving a consultation, what state are you in? Are you open to more THC? Depending on the condition, I will encourage. I'm not about just selling. I'm trying to get people well, right?
Right.
So, you know, here's a few places. I was using a THC CBD to sleep, and it was working really well. And a few weeks ago, there was some misinformation, or they tried in South Dakota to make all CBD illegal. Something happened. This company in Oregon disappeared overnight. 404, can't call them, can't get the medicine.
Wow.
Because, and we're seeing now in the mainstream disinformation, in the sense of like publication like BuzzFeed, which will tell the people that CBD has only been shown to be effective on epilepsy. I wonder why. Because Epidemiolox is about targeting epilepsy. That is not true. There's tons of studies to show. And so on one hand, they are trying to say that CBD is a Schedule One, but from marijuana extract. So it's a technicality because of the 2014 Farm Bill, which protects industrialized hemp. So
and
it really depends.
Are you saying that, is that the law?
Well, that's
that what Schedule One?
Yes. But
from
marijuana.
From marijuana. Not, but if you do it from industrial hemp, it's not Schedule One.
But they are trying to make it a Schedule One all across the board. So depending who interprets the law, I wrote a piece for Truth Out about the politics of CBD and how gray it is, because it can be interpreted in different ways. If I call the DEA, they're going to say I'm doing something that's not right, but I'm selling it. And you can sell it across state lines. It's like you said, you can go to Erewhon. Now things are changing.
It's in everything. Like, it's in juice at Erewhon. It's in cookies at Erewhon. It's, you can buy it plain. It's in everything. So like, It's
called marketing BS because it degrades 89% in the liver. So if you're buying kombucha with effing CBD, it's not going to get to where it's going to get. It's supposed to get.
Just another reason not to buy kombucha, in my opinion. So there's.
Were you being targeted, Maryam, because yours was cannabis CBD versus?
No, mine is not cannabis CBD. Mine has less than 0.3 THC.
So why were they targeting you? Given that you can go on Amazon.
I do things like this, and I speak out, and I have a big mouth, and I just happen to make a movie. I don't know. I can't prove it. I don't want to sound self-important because I'm a spec. Two, I don't want to sound like a zealot or a conspiracy theorist. I can just tell you I've made a movie about Bayer crop science, systemic pesticides. It so happens that I'm also creating a CBD and that GW is partnered with Bayer. If I tell you the series of things that have occurred, waking up in the morning, being banned as a person from PayPal, not in addition to my company, being banned as an environmental activist on a platform such as GoFundMe, because I thought, okay, well, I can't get the medicine to the people. Maybe someone can help donate a bottle because we were so behind in production. The copy was not even launched officially. The copy just disappeared and I got banned. No warning.
Give you a statement? Did they give you an explanation as to why?
Yes, but very, legalese, just not clear, very cryptic message. I've had other, like PayPal, tell me straight out it's because you sell CBD.
Don't they process other merchants who sell CBD?
Say again?
Doesn't PayPal process other merchants who sell CBD?
Yeah, I know some,
but they're not speaking out. So I get what you're saying.
Right. Plus, you were already on Bayer's radar from the vanishing of the bees. So,
I mean, I don't know. Am I? Because I'm. I don't know. We're finding activists, face down in pools, but we can't prove anything. They've all 88 doctors. They've all committed suicide.
Well, I think it's more than 88 now. I think it's up to like 175. And they all all commit suicide with two bullets to the head, not just one. And I mean, if they're trying to make it seem like real, if they're trying to make it seem like it's suicide, they're doing a bad job of it. But that's how they are with everything. They're mocking people. They're being like, we're going to make it look ridiculous, and you're going to believe us anyway because you're all under mind control. And so you know what I mean? Like, there's a few people. I think that's really it, more than anything, right? Like, more than. Not that you aren't targeted because you've been speaking out and because you made a film about that. You're targeted because you're aware. Once, you know what I mean? Like, once the system becomes aware that you are aware of it, then it's almost like something just energetically begins to happen. You know what I mean? Like, it's, if you ask me, we're living in a simulation. And so once the simulation knows you're aware of it, it starts interacting with you in a completely different way. So
I'm not going to say that I have not thought of that because of the strangeness of things and seeing maybe even glitches in the matrix.
Oh, yeah.
However, as a journalist,
yeah,
and what I want to present to the world, to whatever platform I have access to, which includes penetrating the mainstream, I have to be very sound in sticking as a journalist to the facts. I can go off and have my own definitely awakening more and more since the age of 13, definitely propelled by eating real food, as to being in the matrix and seeing everything that's happening. However, if I speak to someone in the mainstream, unless I can prove it, they will just pass me off. And I have to be very careful because they're doing that very easily these days. I mean, Roseanne, hi.
Yeah.
Crazy with her. Maryam, have you ever felt unsafe? Like, are you concerned given what's going on?
I was going to say that when I came back, I mean, because everything kind of hit the fan when I came back from Greece in September, because as a digital nomad and someone who doesn't make tons of money, it's more cost effective and better for my mental health to be in Greece. And I can get into what happened when I came back. But I can tell you that waking up in the morning, because I ended up having liens on my merchant processors. So my first chakra really threatened just survival, waking up at five and wondering, is someone going to take money from our bank account? $13,000 missing, holding on to $20,000 here. We're going to hold on to your $15,000 here, another $7,000 here. How the fuck do I run a business?
Right.
And who do I go to? Can't call anybody and say, please help me. And when I have, and I'm a strong woman, I've had like a lawyer that I filed a complaint against in when Me Too was exploding. And I've never played the gender card. And I spoke about this with Dani, that telling me that I'm acting like a damsel in distress. And I had fucking loan sharks calling me, telling me they're going to blow up my company, telling me we hate bees and hanging up like, oh my God, regressing back to like being nine and being called fatso and being crank called. What the fuck? Are these adults?
Right.
So yes, I have definitely thought, yeah, some of these people did commit suicide. They don't know where to go. The FDA is going to arrest them. They're going to be in jail. They are committing suicide, but not because they want to, because they realize they're stuck in this matrix and they can't get out. And yes, I've felt that.
Yeah.
And I've had to be my warrior self. And what I've accomplished pretty much alone with a few angels in the past 6 months, I've taken my power back. And but yeah, I am concerned. I'm concerned about speaking right now, because I can't prove anything. And you can just, something, you know, I was on the freeway 3 weeks ago, and literally the car, and I was thinking of this, thinking of shit like this happening. On the freeway, 70, 101, all of a sudden car goes down to 40, and there's cars. I luckily thought to honk as I put my, and have to veer from the, all the way to the left to the far right. Could have definitely died. Can't prove anything. And I'm not saying there was anything. I'm just saying that there is a concern when you hear of all these people just.
I think there's a variety of things happening. I think there are people being taken out. I think there are people who are targeted individuals and are being triggered into suicide. And then I think there are people that just get really, really depressed over what you just talked about. They recognize, oh my God, we're in something. We're in a construct, we're in a matrix and a system that I figured out an answer to something. And like now they're just like pulling all the plugs and there's no way for me to get out. Even though I sort of know the way out, they've sort of shut the door. And
that's why I'm watching Westworld.
Right. Well, yeah. Yeah. So
Maryam, what's your experience as a journalist in getting publications to run this stuff these days?
Well, I kind of hung up my hustling freelance hat because, I mean, I before my accident would go to New York once a year, meet with editors and put myself out there. Of course, I was writing, my beats were sex and Hollywood back then, spirituality, but not food supply. So now I work with Truth Out. I work with Rolling Acres, U.S. Acres. They accepted a story on the faux faith of science, where I describe how corrupt scientific trials are and studies, and who's funding them, and how off they are. So I have not really gone to the mainstream to publish. I pitched Vice because I was studying blue zones and longevity. And just real quick, you know, you have this pristine, Dan Buettner of Nat Geo has made this whole industry on blue zones, and people, Americans, literally go to, let's say, this island in Greece and think they're not going to die. Okay. After staying there for 2 months, seeing, oh my God, they're smuggling, there's stories of smuggling Roundup. They're messing up with the potato seeds and putting in GMO. There's two illegal landfills. They're dumping shit in the water. They're on and on. I was like, I can uncover this. No one's written about this. Vice told me, we talked to our editors and no one knows what a blue zone. Are these fucking millennials? So you only report on shit you know? What? and then Slate telling me it's kind of a given that the Western world has infiltrated, which is, so who will publish these things and how much energy do I have?
One people are saying, well, nobody knows what this is. And the other people are saying, well, duh. and there's nothing, right? Like you have both extremes and nobody, that's fascinating.
So, I had gone through, pitched to several mainstream, and now being under siege is what I call these past 6 months, I've not really been able to operate as the visionary journalist, functional coach, the things that I want to do, because I'm running operations and I'm running a $1 million company with very little backup so that I can save money to get out of the hole that we got in because of all the things. And when people, you know, maybe talk about honey calling when I'm speaking to investors, people forget we got shut down fucking 5 times and here we are still making, we're making $75,000 a month without, I'm not trying. I'm just staying afloat so I can pay off my debts. I'm so galvanized at what I'm offering, my articles, the caliber of the articles, the caliber of the products. However, because of the Amazon culture, the customer service has been, up until recently, crap. Oh my God, when I came back, I had so many angry customers. My employees at the time were not being honest with me because I was saying, be upfront, I'm transparent. If you know me, I don't mince words. And I've had to clean all that up, and I've had an opportunity to really have my finger on the dial. Like I have my live chat on. I'm customer service. But I really feel galvanized as to what we're offering and the value here, and that I'm not going to be kicked off the island.
Yeah. I spent some time going through, looking at your website. You do really have a lot of interesting things and a lot of interesting articles and an interesting store there. But if I'm understanding you correctly, you don't sell your own main product there. You have a separate website for that because that causes problems for the rest of
the CBD. No, we sell products on Honey Colony.
Yeah, but you sell, but your main product, which is the one that you created, the CBD, that's on a separate site.
It's on something transformative because of the because of the legalities, because of the politics, and also I don't take credit card anymore. And it's a personal, it's a trigger point when I have a customer say, do you accept PayPal? And it's like, do you fucking see PayPal on the site? No. But it's not because I'm angry at them. It's because I'm angry that I can't offer them PayPal.
Right.
I don't want to offer them a credit card company because I've been burned by two entities. I had a high-risk merchant processor defraud us $20,000. The other processor, which the CEO calls himself God, and he is a god, in the CBD world, little trouble, Maryam. Let's just flick that switch off. They asked in December to change FDA compliance to be in FDA compliance. So that meant going into testimonials and scrubbing words like cancer, fibro, whatever ailment.
Yeah.
Okay? So obviously that rubs me the wrong way as a journalist who believes in the First Amendment, only later to realize that the processors can dictate their own rules that are sometimes even more strict than the FDA because they want to protect their booties.
So it was the credit card processors who are telling you to scrub those words from the site?
Yes, on behalf of the FDA. Like to be
the FDA's minions now?
Yeah.
They want to be in compliance. No one wants to get in trouble with the FDA. So number two, they said, so we can't link Honey Colony to Simply Transformative, but we were linking articles. If you want more information, go to Honey Colony to empower people, or go to PubMed or go to NIH. Quote, FDA does not recognizes other research as bias. So the FDA dictates what is bias and what is not bias. So
based
then I said
what?
Articles. Like if I say CBD is a neuroprotectant linked to a study by the NIH or PubMed government sites, that too was according to them. Well, I asked him, does NIH or PubMed count? He didn't know. So that night I raised my voice. Bad girl, right? Can't show emotion. You have to be in this male, like no emotion world. So he said, why are you raising your voice? And I'm sorry. I even said, I'm sorry. Haven't you read the Four Agreements? Don't take it personally. I'm a journalist. I did not like that comment. So a couple of hours later, went into the portal to do a transaction, could not get into the porting. That was December. No access to my own accounting for 6 months. I found out, I didn't know for about 3 months. I guessed it was 10K that they were holding. They were holding on to 15K. Okay. We're going to give you back five. No, go fuck yourself. Show me the accounting. How are you coming up with this calculation? I, over the weekend, because I'm not the one who did the due diligence, there was no due diligence, and we were desperate for a processor, and this was the god of the CBD processors. I read this document, and it's a fortress. If they wanted to, they could have said anything and given me zilch. So I said, you give me 7,500, you keep my other half, and let's call it a day. And that's what happened. Just... I had the first processor that defrauded me out of China. Like when I started doing my due diligence and I get a customer service and my contact person is Bruce Lee, something's fucking up, right? So I tell my employees, I pull out of China. I would have never gone with that choice, but I was told to delegate, to not get in operations, and the company was big and I just kind of let go of the reins. So they held on to 20. In front of my eyes, they started playing with the books. I, under my breath, to one of the loan sharks. Now, I had loans with high interest, and then they defaulted. So I was actually working, I call them the loan sharks for the loan sharks, the collectors for the loans. So under my breath, I told one guy, well, why don't you put a lien on said company. You guys are in the business of collecting money. You'll do a better job. They did it. They did it. And I got that motherfucker on the phone and I got out of 20K, I got 10K out of him. And that's when he, in front of my eyes, I logged into the portal and it didn't say they owed us 18,000. All of a sudden it said they owed us 9,900, whatever. So cooking books in front of me. And I don't have the time. I've already done so much forensic accounting, taught myself to do Excel sheets and shit, that, you know, it'll be a war for another day. I've just had to cut my losses. But very scummy people in this industry where CBD is helping so many sick people. And I know because I speak to them. Parkinson's, broken neck, insomnia, anxiety, PTSD, you name it. I have people on my medicine that are finding relief. How beautiful is that? And not being allowed.
And are you writing articles that are differentiating between like the shitty industrial quality CBD and what you're putting out? And is that part of what's going on? Like,
well, I've done stories on, for instance, on what to look for. And I'm doing a lot of education on why is it. And mine is not even that expensive. There's people who are doubling what I'm selling. It's, I wanted to make it affordable and I've had to bring up the price because of all the money I've lost and the processing fee, blah, blah, blah. So I found one because I've been shopping for processors, right? And found, for instance, one that said, yeah, we'll take credit cards. You have to sign a 5-year agreement. I said, marriages don't last this long anymore. There's no way I'm signing a 5-year agreement. Then I found another processor who said, if you sell less than 0.3 THC, if you sell zero THC in your formula, then we'll take you on. So what does that mean? That means if you're making a cheap CBD isolate. So CBD isolates, we talked about the full plant synergy. You want the entourage effect, which means you need the minimal to get the entourage effect is 0.3 THC. You want to have a little for the different terpenes, the different we have CB1 and CB2 receptors and a cannabinoid system. And that's why I say the plant is interfacing with our body. So if we have zero THC, that means it's probably a CBD isolate, which means it's probably from China or India and it's super cheap. Now we have to also explain cannabis is such an amazing plant. It's also a bioaccumulator. So they literally use the cannabis plant to clean the soil in Chernobyl. Mm-hmm. So it sucks up everything in the earth. If you're sick, if you're not sick, do you want to be taking heavy metals and chemicals? Hell no. So I came to my understanding, oh, you're a processor. You allow to sell shit. You're good with shit. Shit is okay. If it has zero THC, you're cool with that. You don't give a fuck where it comes from. Whereas I'm taking the precautions to offer quality and safeguards, that's not allowed.
Okay, so it seems to me, I'll make this jump because I am a conspiracy theorist. And I don't have to worry about what people think of me as far as that. That, like, if Bayer and Monsanto and these kinds of companies, right? Because now Bayer is with Monsanto.
They're the same.
They're in bed with the FDA. And if they really have their hooks into all of these other large corporations and banks and all this other kind of stuff, and they're interested in selling a synthetic product that is, it would be in their interest to make sure that most people, when they have an experience with real CBD, it's crappy, so that they will actually think that theirs is better. And so that's the whole point, that these banks that work with Bayer will continue to process these shitty people because they know that they're essentially, you know, eliminating competition, and the quality of whatever Bayer comes up with will be better than that, even though it's synthetic, because that is crap.
Well, if you go on Amazon, they have no problem selling CBD. There's CBD on Amazon. So again, why am I having so many?
Will they sell good CBD on Amazon, or is it just the crappy CBD?
No. And even the Prime My Body, which isn't a good CBD. So I'm not knocking it, but they're an MLM. So they have, from what I've heard, which I don't know as for a fact, is that they have a cozy relationship with a bank, possibly in Canada. So they have no worries, and they're making lots of money.
Right.
So I'm a little guy, but I focus on quality. Quality. Right. We live in mediocre times. I abhor mediocrity. I do. I want to strive for excellence. I almost died. I want to be the best version of myself. I want to excel. I want to give something back so I don't have children. That's my way of.
Well, and the other thing is, you actually know what you're talking about all of these things. Like, a lot of these people have just figured out, oh, I can make money selling CBD. This is the actual trend. So, like, it's people aren't, there's not, they don't make people nervous. They're easy to knock off when the time comes because they don't actually know what they're talking about. You're a formidable competitor, right? And so, like, they want to make sure you can't even show up in the ring. Like, I mean, it really all makes perfect sense on the level that they operate from. What do you, I kind of want to, while we're sort of here with this topic before we move into other things in the next hour, how is this all related to this legalization of marijuana that we're experiencing now? Because it is, to me, I think humans should be able to do whatever they want, and we're talking about a plant that comes from Earth and all that kind of stuff, but like this sudden, all of a sudden, after all of these years of prohibition of it, all of this legalization, like, it feels like there has to be something behind it that most people are not quite seeing yet. And
it's a miracle plant, a bow to the bees and
no, bugs. No, that's not. Yeah. That's right. I get that.
I know. Yeah.
But like, there has to be a reason why all of a sudden now they're allowing it. Like, what do they have coming down the pipe that is the reason that they're allowing this?
June 27th, Pedalox.
Right. Is it just the epilepsy medicine?
But
there is more in the pipeline. So let's back up and say that even though they've tried to do it as a Schedule 1 CBD, as from marijuana extract, that they've also patented CBD as a neuroprotectant antioxidant. So clearly they know the benefits. And I think that let's go back a little, because this is new to me as a Canadian, finding out about reefer madness, because I also, when I first smoked at 19, which is relatively late, I went out with a wannabe Rasta and went to Jamaica with him. And had all these preconceived notions. And I've joked and said, you know, my mom is like, Mary, are you still smoking the green stuff? Yes, I am. And I was very shy to say it as it became part medicinal. So if we go back, Hearst wanted to outlaw hemp because of the industry. Right.
Yeah, newspaper industry and all that, yes.
So, and then Nixon wanted to find a weapon against Vietnam, people who were against Vietnam, mm-hmm. and African-Americans, mm-hmm. and made it a Schedule One there. So to deny the fact that it has any medicinal properties in 2018 is like bonkers. What the fuck? It's crazy.
Well, yeah, when the same government that's saying it has no medicinal value also has the patent on it, when you, like, right, it's, I mean, but this is the cognitive dissonance in every arena that we live under here, you know, at least most people do. But so that stuff I get, but what I'm kind of asking here is the legalization of marijuana, just moving over to marijuana for a second. Like, it feels to me like the reason it's all of a sudden being allowed is because they're getting ready to usher in some kind of Bayer, Monsanto, GMO marijuana. And then that's going to, like, somehow this will all morph into that's either the only thing that's legal or that, you know, it infests all of the organic stuff.
They're patenting strains. There's talk that Monsanto was involved with GMO marijuana. And they certainly have fake synthetic THC in the pipeline, Marinol, mm-hmm. a lot of patents. They have definitely a plan that probably has extended, you know, this.
Like I think what they're going to do, like, this is just my conspiratorial mind going, is we now have several states that it's legal in, but it's still not federally legal. And so people end up in this gray zone where their businesses are at risk and all this kind of shit and whatever, that what's going to happen is, like, there's going to be enough states legalize it that it hits a turning point, and the federal government is going to say, we legalize it, but they're only going to legalize the Bayer shit or the Monsanto shit or whatever there.
FDA approval. So that's what's happening, where they're only going to recognize.
Right.
This, and now they're peppering the media. So if you are going to get THC, it has to be this because it has to be safe. Let's not talk about what inactive ingredients. How are you extracting this synthetic shit right. with hexane? What stuff are you putting in? And so, yes, it's slowly, it's the same mindset of like, okay, let's scrub Monsanto from the vocabulary now. Just like I have to go into my site, and the person who is vending with PayPal is the one who suggested to me to go in and remove the word CBD and make it, and if you see other brands, they've, so this is stupidity, right? When we're scrubbing words out of our...
We're scrubbing what it is. We're not, like, yeah. It's like, it would like me, like, scrubbing the name Danny from Danny's website, right? Like, just like, it's very silly, you know?
I'm curious, Maryam, because I know that you said YouTube also shut you down.
Where have you been censored?
And I know, and because YouTube also shut down Jambo, which is another cannabis company, and their YouTube channel got pulled. So I'm curious to know what that was about. What story they give you?
Yeah, we spoke to them for a story that we published, but they don't want to be vocal and go on record. Where I am putting myself on the line. Maybe I'm so stupid. It's the same thing. In their case, they just deleted the whole channel, right? I was interviewed a couple of weeks ago by someone who does reviews on marijuana, different strains. His videos also got taken down. In my case, it was a 2-year-old video on specifically superior CBD. But initially, when I woke up that morning and got, you know, greeting from YouTube banning my video and getting a strike, I thought I was being political. I thought it was one of my videos where I'm sounding off and angry and whatever, but I was quite sweet and just explaining the medicine. And
people can't understand what it is, right? So this is the other thing, like, what we've found, you know, a lot of times happens is you do something controversial and they won't take down that video because they don't want you to be able to say, oh, see, I spoke out against something and they took it down. They'll go and they'll take something else of yours down just to give you a strike and get you on that roll of sort of having strikes. And then you're speaking out about having strikes, and then people are afraid to work with you because if they interview you on their channel, then they may get strike and all that. It starts like this whole sort of tumbleweed effect. You know what I mean? Like a domino effect kind of thing. It's a mind fuck game.
I had someone tell me on the phone who later told me that he had to say that on the phone. You should be concerned that you're putting others at risk. And
that's what I'm talking about.
As a conscious person, and I'm so hard on myself, I was like, fuck, who am I putting at risk? And I'm like, the whole day I was like, oh my, and then I thought of that. I'm like, are people not gonna wanna be associated with me? You know, then I had to just stop just that train of thought. But it has been, I mean, look at what's happening on Facebook between conversations where people are having to fight for their right to express themselves. People are unfriending each other. And so these tools that were created for us to explore our self-expression and to be connected are now tools that are being used to oppress and shut us down.
Yep. Yeah.
And I'm just curious, did YouTube state that they don't air cannabis-related content? Because they air some pretty fucked up shit on YouTube.
Yeah, well, yes, they do violent, degrading shit. And I get the CBD alerts on YouTube, and there's videos on YouTube all the time. And I shared my video with a cannabis attorney that I interview, and he didn't know what was wrong with it. And I have to say, you know, I wanted a year ago to go on Bill Maher to talk about the honeybees, because I really respect the fact that he cares about the environment, and to be able to appeal to a big platform to educate people, because it was the 10-year anniversary. Maybe this is a good segue, but over the time, feeling like I need to speak my mind to almost save my life, because if in a way, or maybe this life will disintegrate and I'll just escape to Greece and not be outspoken, because I don't want to take on the machine. Maybe when I started making Vanishing of the Bees, I was naive, but I don't think I can take on the machine. And I think I can be crushed super easy now, having the awareness of the matrix and the smoke and mirrors. But I do want to be able to help people. And my business partners /ex, I think 2 years ago, told me, we need to stop shining a light on what's going on and focus on solutions. And he's always been kind of ahead of he's a visionary too. And I was like, can I do that? Can I shut my mouth and not speak out and research and uncover? And I don't know what the answer is. Obviously, I'm speaking out, and I have concern just speaking right now. But so back to hoping that if I could get on a platform like Bill Maher, where it's the mainstream, and talk about the environment and talk about what's happening with CBD, because people's right to be well is being taken away from them. And one in every two people today has a chronic illness. And there's something called the overturn window, where we slowly accept the unacceptable. Mm-hmm. And Bill talks about this too. It's like, how about next year we, you know, campaign about, like, let's get back to normal. Like, what the fuck is going on? It's topsy-turvy, surreal, crazy shit.
Yeah, actually, it was on Bill Maher that I first heard of your movie many years ago. When Ellen Page being on there talking about it. That was back when I still liked Bill Maher. but you know, yeah, no, I mean, that is a platform that gets you a lot of, you know.
Yeah, whatever your views are, he doesn't care about the environment.
Yeah,
and that is of importance to me.
Yeah. Just quickly, because we've mentioned it a couple times without clearly stating what's going on. Just this week, it has become official that Monsanto is now Bayer, basically, right? Like, that's sort of the whole Bayer bought Monsanto, basically, and then the name is now being changed to Bayer. And people in this country, not enough people, but a lot of people are already, you know, aware of and weary of Monsanto, but most people in this country still think Bayer makes aspirin and the aspirin helps with the heart attacks or heart stuff, and they don't understand the true history of Bayer and all of the things that they've been involved in. And we're going to get into that in the second hour. We're going to talk about Miriam's documentary and how this odd connection that Bayer is connected to sort of the issue with the bees too. And you know, I do find it really, really fascinating that, you know, we have this tremendous concern with the uprise of Nazism, right? And the thing, people think anybody they disagree with now is a Nazi. Meanwhile, you know, this genocidal corporation that comes straight from Nazi Germany has been operating sort of, you know, all of this time, practically in silence. Nobody understands. And, you know, like that's the real threat. Disagreeing with somebody, having a different political view, whatnot, you know, is not this companies like this that have the power to, you know, poison people basically and keep them from their own health. To me, that's the real genocidal threat. And I think it's fascinating.
Sub-lethal, right? Sub-lethal.
Right.
Slowly, killing people slowly.
Yeah. Well, making money. Making money off of them while they're dying.
Oh, hell yeah. Yes. Let's make money off. So this insidious way, whether it's systemic poisoning, whether, you know, there's journalists outright being killed, maimed, muzzled, but there's other ways to kill someone. Mm-hmm. And I've felt like my livelihood has been threatened, whatever, you know, the system, the way the system is. You can blame at least the system. If you're not, you can't prove any one culprit or... So this insidious sublethal, whether we're talking about systemic pesticides and slowly killing the bees or talking about humans. And so, yeah, my message 10 years later is like, we are the bees. We are the ones who are slowly being exposed to sublethal poisons everywhere we look. And this is not a conspiracy. It's if you study the food supply for a decade, if you are aware, then you come to these conclusions.
Yeah, so we're going to take this over into the patrons hour. We're going to get in depth about her work with the bees and whatnot. But before we leave the public segment, can you tell people where they can find your work, your products, and how they can support you?
Thank you. You can buzz on over to honeycolony.com or simplytransformative.com. I am still on Twitter, Maryam Henein. And I'm definitely on Instagram. And you can email me at Maryam, M-A-R-Y-A-M, at honeycolony.com. I'm quite accessible.
Alrighty. So everybody, go check out her stuff. There's interesting things over there at her website that I think you all will enjoy. We're going to take a pause, and patrons, we'll see you on the other side. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week, everybody else. All right. So... Don't know.